so welcome back to Scottish Music again. So today we're very privileged to have Simon Chadwick here to talk to you. He's a harp player from St Andrews and an archaeologist and has been working in the field of the ancient the old Gaelic harp style for a very long time and is a foremost exponent on that, and he's brought in harps which he will tell you about, the significant reconstructions of early early harps. So yeah, first you all over. Do you any questions before being that? Right, Simon Chadwick, thank you
very much. So today we're gonna have a kind of quick overview of the harp in Scotland from earliest times right up to the present day. And this is such a huge subject that it's kind of a challenge to put your head around it. And it's interesting because there's different strands which kind of fight with each other. So this is one of the things I'm interested in. The most obvious way there's different strands is that there's different kinds of harps, different harp traditions that happen at the same time or happen one after each other. But the other thing that is really interesting is the way it connects into wider culture. So there's a whole thing about harps being more important as symbols than they are as musical instruments. Everybody has ideas about the harp. I tease my students sometimes. I had some new students and I asked them, why are you interested in learning the harp? And they're like, oh, the harp is so beautiful, you know, and it's so ancient and it has this kind of slightly mystical ambience. And I said, well, it's interesting because if it had been a banjo class, you would never have got that response. You know, the banjo doesn't have these great national myths hanging on it. It doesn't make you think of angels and healing and all these kind of things. And I thought, well, why not? Both of them are just bits of wood with strings on. So the harp has something bizarre going on that's completely not musical and completely divorced from its use as a musical instrument. And that's quite interesting because you can study that on its own, the harp as a symbol, but it actually gets in the way of its musical use as well, because you can't just sit down and play a harp like you can sit down and play a banjo, because as soon as you use it out of the case, it goes, there's all this expectation and preconceived ideas that you have to deal with. Because we're going to go back into quite a distant past with this story, because the harp is one of the older musical instruments that you get in Scottish music. If you go right back to medieval times or before, you have to consider a wider scene, because the idea of Scotland as a kind of unitary nation state that you can separate off culturally from the rest of the world is not that ancient. And so especially with the harp, which belongs to a Gaelic cultural context, you have to think of the old Gaelic world, which is shared between Ireland and Scotland, mostly with the west of Scotland, but the further back you go, the more the old Gaelic world reached down into this part of the world. So I think, certainly in earlier medieval times, the whole of Scotland had some Gaelic language present, and it was the high status language. So things like the coronation of the King of Scots in medieval times would be accompanied with Gaelic poetry and genealogy recitation, because it was the high status language of Scotland, and it's gradually been retreating. I think in Scotland it's been retreating more geographically, it's got further north and west, and in Ireland it's been retreating sort of everywhere. But you can see that's quite a recent thing, and so I'm very interested in this connection between the harp traditions and the Gaelic language and literary and cultural traditions, because I think they're very important, and they're something that you can't, if you ignore, you get a different picture of how things are working. So I put this map up just to give you an impression. This is the old Gaelic world. So this is really what I want to talk about. Because if you ignore harps in Ireland, you get a very skewed picture of the harp traditions as they relate to Scotland. So you have to address this. And a lot of scholarship doesn't and deals with Scottish harps and deals with Irish harps quite in isolation. And it's kind of a shame because they both miss out on half the story. But the flip side of that is if you're studying the Scottish harp tradition at any time, you can use scholarly work on Irish harps because it relates in lots of different ways. Okay, so in your bibliography I've given you quite a few articles and books that are specifically relevant to the harp in Ireland, but you can use that to get cultural background and ideas and methods and symbolism and all that kind of thing to inform work on the harp in Scotland. So I said about the harp being ancient. Everybody's really interested in the harp as an ancient thing, you know? People are much less interested in the ancient origins of other instruments, but the harp has this magical thing going on which makes it more ancient than anything else. And so these are the oldest harp things in Scotland, and there are similar things like this in Ireland as well. And so what you basically get is an early medieval stone cross shaft, and it's decorated with Old Testament scenes. They would originally have been painted bright colours, I guess. And some of the scenes have King David holding a triangular stripy thing, because a stringed instrument is the symbol of King David. And so if you look, you can see him at the bottom left. This is a stone from Monifieth, just up the coast, the other side of Dundee. And there he is with a triangular stripy thing in front of him. And then on the right is the Dublin cross, which is down the other end of Fife. It originally was on a hill above Fonterio, which is the Pictish royal king centre, and is now in Dunning Church. And you can see on the side there is a person sitting on a chair with a big triangular striking thing in front of them. So this is presumably King David. And so people get very excited by this. Go, look how ancient the harp is in Scotland. And you can instantly start saying things about these harps, like how many strings they have, and how they're tuned, and how they're made, and the kind of music that's played on them. And it's all fantasy, because all we have is a rather eroded stone sculpture, kind of in isolation. And some people have gone the other way and said, well, you know, these stone carvers, basically all the designs on these stones are copied out of gospel books or carpets that were imported from Europe or even from Byzantium. So actually, this is nothing to do with indigenous music making. This is like a stock image of King David from a Byzantine carpet. And those are kind of extreme views, and so I think the answer is something in between. That yes, these are stereotyped stock images, but people would have recognised a triangular stripy thing as a musical instrument. And we can't really say much more about music making in Scotland than that. Do you see what I mean? It's very unsatisfactory, but that's what this game is all about. So you have King David with triangular stripy things. You get these stock images coming elsewhere. This one's fun because at first sight this is very exciting. This is the Iona Psalter, and we know that this book was the prayer book of the prioress Beatrice on Iona. She was descended from the Lords of the Isles, so it's this really old West Coast Gaelic aristocratic context. And you think, how perfect, how evidence of harp performance practice from there. Maybe this is what her harp would look like. Maybe this man was sitting in her chambers in her residence on Iona in 1200. Except, of course, it's not like that, because prayer books like this are international commodities, and this one was done in Oxford for her, based on continental models. So this, again, this tells us nothing about music performance practice in Scotland. So it's all... it's like hints. It's like you can see that there's something's going on, but it's not what you think it is, and it's very difficult to actually get anything concrete and sensible to say about this very old stuff. I talked about different types of harp. There's a thing about the harp as well. It's people say the harp, okay, and you think, yeah, there's the harp. And it's a type of instrument, a little bit like the violin or the clarinet. But it's not actually like that at all, because if you talk about the clarinet, that's quite a specific thing to talk about. You know, if it is a clarinet, it has all these features that can do certain things. And if it has different features, like you can make it out of metal and bendy instead of wood and straight, it becomes a saxophone and it's not a clarinet anymore. And nobody would think that a clarinet and a saxophone are the same thing, would they? Okay. But the harp is a really, really general and generic category of musical instrument. So if you say the harp, that's kind of the equivalent of saying the reed instrument. And you could be talking about clarinets or saxophones or bagpipes. on oboes or bassoons, and it doesn't really matter because they're all the reed instruments and nobody really bothers about any differences between them. So this is the situation you're in with the harp. Okay, there's lots and lots of different, completely different types of instruments, and the only things that, that connects them is that they're vaguely triangular and the string's got the middle. Okay, and that's all. So this picture here is very interesting. This is more realistic than you might look think at first. this is King David again, because King David is our go-to man if we want to see pictures of harps. This is King David, he's playing a harp. He's in a literate context, reading from a book, which is very interesting, because I'm always interested in literate and non-literate music. The harp he's playing, you can recognise this type of harp, because there are extant examples on the continent. This is the normal type of European harp from perhaps the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th century. It's very slender, it's very tall and thin, it has gut strings, and it has little hooks at the bottom that rattle against the string, so it buzzes like a sitar. Okay? And this is one of the reasons why we use the word harp for this kind of instrument in English, because harp has this sense of kind of being a bit rattly, a bit snarly, you harp on about something. Think of the sound of a harpsichord, it's called that because it has that kind of snarly, snappy, rattly sound. So this is a normal type of continental harp, and I have no problem thinking that that continental kind of harp is called a bray harp because the hooks make it bray like a donkey. This kind of bray harp was the normal musical instrument in the whole of Europe, and it was pretty normal in English and Scots-speaking parts of Scotland. So you find this in Edinburgh and in the Lowlands in this part of the world in the 17th century. Okay, I'm not going to talk any more about that tradition because other people have done research on it and I haven't, and it's not my main interest, but it's worth being aware. You do get these foreign traditions coming in, and they're quite unrelated to the native traditions. What I'm interested in is the native Scottish and Irish traditions, because they're quite different from the rest of Europe. So these are stone sculptures from the 15th century up in the far west. So the one on the left is from Skye, and the one on the right is from Iona. And we're back in the same territory that we have. It's triangular. They're not even strifely, are they? Because the stones are so eroded. They're just triangular things in front of people. And so they give you this idea that if you're an aristocrat, if you're really high status and you wanted to show your learning and your culture and your wealth, you have a sword for your knightly status, you have a horse, you have a person playing the harp as part of that whole package of aristocratic culture. And this is confirmed by the aristocratic poetry and other information from that time. So we get a sense that harp playing is embedded in that aristocratic Gaelic royal and princely and noble culture in the west of Scotland, just as it is in Ireland in late medieval times. But you see, the game changes completely when you start talking about that, because we have complete extant musical instruments from this time as well. And so these are the two famous late medieval Gaelic harps. The one on the left is the Brian Boru harp, which is kept in Trinity College in Dublin. And the one on the right is the Queen Mary harp, which is kept in the National Museum in Edinburgh. And neither of these has been dated properly. So scholars and art historians guess like mad about how old they are. They're probably not even all made at the same time. They're probably composite objects because they were repaired and kept in use for centuries. The Queen Mary harp on the right, you see it's got decoration running down the front section with leaves and tendrils. This matches the late 15th century Iona stone carving, so this gives you some kind of provenance and dating, at least for that part of that harp. But the two instruments are very similar, they're the same size, they're the same number of strings, they're basically set up in the same way. Even the decoration is very similar, following the same motif. And so I would say that these are as similar as two violins. So say you have a Stradivarius violin and then a Amati violin. They're basically the same, even though there's very subtle differences between them. And so the same with these two harps. They're to all intents and purposes identical, although in almost every detail there's slight differences. So they come from different craftsmen, different workshops, but they're the same instrument tradition. And I find that very interesting. And so you can use features of each to illuminate pictures. Karen Loomis at the University of Edinburgh has done a huge campaign of study on the Queen Mary harp, putting it through a CAT scanning machine, getting internal x-rays, doing materials testing of the different parts of it, including the pigments, to find out exactly how it was made and damaged and used over its working life. And she's written a good thesis about that, and she's published articles about that, which are in her bibliography. The same work has not been done on the Brian Baruch harp in Trinity College. It would be nice if it was, but it hasn't happened yet. And I wonder if this comes back to our political thing, that it's more difficult to study the harp in Ireland because it has even more mythical and cultural weight on it. You know, it's all very well to say, let's do carbon dating on the Queen Mary harp. It hasn't happened yet, but I'm hopeful that it will eventually. It's all very well to find out the date of the Queen Mary harp. Does it date from 1200 or 1500, or is it an 18th century fake? Who knows? But it's a bit like the Turin Shroud. You can't do that work on Brian Baruch harp because the risk of finding out that it's not as ancient as everyone wants it to be is too great because of its symbolic role as the national symbol. So these are difficult things that instantly get in the way of just doing ordinary kinds of research. But there's a huge amount of information you can tell about ancient music performance practice from looking at these objects. And one of the things that I've done is I commissioned a sculptor, an instrument maker, to make a copy of the Queen Mary harp. And so this is like a museum archaeological reconstruction. Everything on it is for it to be as exactly the same as the one in the museum as possible. And then you can do experiments on it. You can put strings on it and see how it works. You can try playing it and see what kind of sound it has. And you can use that to understand late medieval harp performance practice in that context. Does that make sense? So there's no strings on the Queen Mary harp. The strings on the Trinity College harp were put on in the 1960s, so they're not ancient either. So you have to do a lot of work to work out how it works. You have to work out how to string it. You have to work out how to tune it. You have to work out how to play it. And this is a lot of kind of archaeomusicological detective work. We know that metal strings were completely normal for the ancient Gaelic harp traditions, right back to earliest times, right through until the end of the tradition. And there are hints and tips about tuning and intonation and these kind of things. And so I have this replica set up in what I think is a reasonable approximation of a medieval setup. Although, of course, I change my mind every 6 months and take all the strings off and try something new. So I'll play a little bit of the kind of way I imagine the medieval harps would have sounded in the 15th century, just to give you a sense. Thank you. and so on. And that's just one section out of 12 or 24 that would grow gradually in a kind of ever-increasing display of floridity. So a little sense of the kind of sounds that you might expect to hear out of the medieval harps in the 15th century. So these incredibly high status, aristocratic, learned music traditions of the west of Ireland, west of Scotland and of Ireland, carry on and develop and gradually go downhill because of active suppression of high status aristocratic Gaelic culture. And this is a very interesting aspect of the harp tradition specifically, and it ties us into the wider politics of Gaelic language and culture. There's basically this lecture is in the folk music strand, isn't it, in this series?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is wildly inappropriate because the harp is not a folk instrument and never has been in Scotland. It's an aristocratic high art music. Okay. But why then is it put in the folk music strand? Nobody knows. It's really interesting. I think what's going on is that there's this kind of very interesting colonial thing that because it's Gaelic and not Anglo-European, it's therefore lower status. And if it's lower status, it must be folk. So I think that there's a very interesting thing going on that's a very kind of long-term colonial hangover of doing down the native art traditions by belittling them, by thinking that they're not interesting, by thinking that they're low status, by thinking that they're peasant music and peasant traditions. Okay. So if you go back to medieval times, then the Gaelic world and the Gaelic kings were the equals of any other kings in the whole of Europe. But they gradually got taken over by colonial rule from London, and so the whole suppression of their language and traditions and culture is part of that. And it goes back hundreds and hundreds of years. It goes back to Elizabethan times at least. But we still live with it today as an active thing because these noble aristocratic music traditions get labelled folk music. Okay? This would be the equivalent of saying, oh, Handel is folk music because he's just English.
I find that interesting though, because we do think of the harp as kind of higher, or
yeah.
At least I thought it was.
Yeah, but it is, that's right, yes. So yeah, like I say, this is very complicated and very interesting. And people have done a bit more work on this in Ireland, because in Ireland these colonial issues are much more alive. And so there are studies of the Irish harp as a symbol of colonial rule and simultaneously as a symbol of independence and resistance. You don't really get that in the Scottish context, which I think is quite interesting. So I think there's less awareness of these issues in Scottish Gaelic and Scottish culture generally, but I think it's really interesting and really significant. So keep an eye out. And whenever you see native art labelled as folk, then you know that you're in the presence of that colonial mindset. So you can start to twitch and think, just a second, why is this being labelled folk? Anyway, so back where we were. So it's going downhill, which I find interesting as well. So you have these great aristocratic traditions, and they're losing their patronage, not because they're losing it because it's just disappearing, but because it's being actively suppressed by the bureaucracy and by the administration originating out of London and then its regional proxies. But anyway, so when you get to the 17th century, you get notated examples of harp music, because it was always an oral tradition. And again, people say, oh, oral tradition, therefore low status, therefore folk. And that's rubbish as well, because high status art music, oral traditions are all over the world, including in the Anglo-European classical music scene. So it's not till the 17th century that harp music starts to get written down into the lute books that you were studying just the other day. So those lute books contain our earliest notated examples of harp music. And even though it was written down, the harp music continued to be an oral tradition right to the very end, which I find very interesting. To the extent that towards the end of the tradition, it became common for the harpist to be blind, so for blind people specifically going into harp playing. A little bit like nowadays, blind people go into piano tuning. It was seen as a suitable vocation for a blind musician. And I think there's a connection there with the oral nature of the old harp tradition, that it was very learned and very difficult, but because it was oral, it was a suitable thing for a blind, for an educated, intelligent blind person to do. So there's a typical story would be Rory Dal Morrison from the Isle of Lewis, and he was going to study, he was in Inverness at seminary studying to be a priest, and then he became blind. And so for somebody of that status and ambition, going to study the harp was a suitable alternative career to going into the priesthood. Now what happened in Scotland in the 18th century is that the Gaelic harp traditions disappeared completely. Okay. Now in Ireland, for some reason, and I'm not quite sure what's going on here, so there's such cultural changes, such social and cultural changes. In Scotland, the harp dies out completely. The pipes almost died out, and they were kind of saved by being transferred into the military, amongst other things. But the harp didn't have anything to save it, and it died out in Scotland in the second half of the 18th century. I think the last harp was alive just after 1750. But in Ireland, the harp tradition managed to keep going, and partly it changed a little bit, it became more up to date. And so this is an 18th century Irish harpist, but he toured in Scotland, and this is very interesting as well, that the networks of touring and patronage were still up and running, even though there were no harpers left in Scotland. So Dennis and Hampsey travelled to Scotland at least twice, I think, and toured around, going to the big houses, playing for patrons. He got an introduction to Prince Charles Edward Stuart's court at Holyrood House and played for the prince and got a white rosette as his souvenir, which he was very proud of. And on the right is his harp, which is still kept and it's preserved in the Guinness Museum in Dublin. And this is Anne Heyman, who was my harp mentor when I started out and still is. And this is her holding it and demonstrating as a human scale, so you can see it's significantly bigger than the medieval harps, but that's normal for musical instruments to design to grow over time. This is my simplified copy of Dennis Hampsey's harp, and I'll play one of his tunes on it. So this is the kind of thing that you would have heard in the mid-18th century from a visiting Irish harpist plugging into those Scottish aristocratic patronage networks. And Dennis Hampshire was very interesting because he deliberately preserved in much older repertory. That tune I just played is connected to some of the 17th century Scottish tunes. So he preserved a much older repertory, but at the end of his life, he met the musicologist, an ethnomusicologist and music collector, Edward Bunting, who wrote down a lot of his tunes in quite a lot of detail. So we have a transcribed record of the performance style and repertory of this 18th century harpist in the old Gaelic harp tradition, which is very cool, and is what I use to reconstruct how the music would have worked. So in Ireland, Dinis O'Hampsey was one of the last of the old Irish harpists. He had no students, and there was perhaps 10 harpists alive in Ireland in around 1800, and they were clearly all about to die, and none of them had any students. And so there was an organised attempt to revive the harp. They organised charitable schools in Belfast and Dublin, and they recruited poor blind boys to come and learn the harp. And these schools stuttered on for a couple of generations. And so this man, Patrick Byrne, is a second generation student of these charitable schools. So he was taught in direct succession from the old harpers. Patrick Byrne also toured a lot, and he came to Scotland, and he came to Edinburgh. And when he was at Edinburgh, there was a really interesting thing happened, is that he was kind of fated by society. He played for the Queen and for Prince Albert and all this kind of thing. But he got roped into the Waverley Balls. And he played the harp in the Waverley Ball in Edinburgh in 1845. This picture shows him dressed up smart in his evening suit. But for the ball, he was dressed in blankets and plaids and with a laurel wreath on his head. And he did a little kind of living tableau at the ball where he was the last minstrel. And this is very interesting because this plugs into a whole narrative of the harp as an ancient thing. And it interests me that people in Scotland at that time still recognise the power of the Irish harpist to connect to the old Gaelic traditions. There's a real ossianic thing going on there. And so this is interesting that it's not obvious that at that late date that kind of pan-Gaelic connections would still be seen, but it's, on some level they still were. So there he is. He's got a big. His harp is even bigger, but again, that's normal. We expect the instrument design to grow over time. And then on the right is an example of a similar harp. There was a whole series were made and presented to each of the blind boys when they graduated from the school. And so there's an example of one in the Cambridge Museum. I'm not going to play an example of his music because I haven't got the harp big enough. But also, I've grown my nails a bit long because to play in the old style of the medieval style, Dinis O'Hampsey's archaic style, whereas Patrick Byrne would have used the tips of his fingers for a much softer, much more romantic sound. And I have been experimenting with that, but I'm not doing nails and no nails in one day. It's too much, too much effort. You have to imagine that softer sound. But his harp is still set up in the same way as in the same tradition going right back to medieval times. It still has the strings made of brass wire, which give you this resonance. Okay, that amazing metallic resonance that is really characteristic of the old Scottish and Irish harp sound. And two strings in the middle tuned to the same note, which is a specific feature of the old Scottish and Irish Gaelic harp traditions. I haven't ever seen in any other harp tradition anywhere else. And it gives the harp even more of a resonance, it gives it a kind of drone effect. And so that's a common feature right back to medieval times, right through until 1845, 1850s, when Patrick Byrne was around. And it's a really special sound. I mean, it's really unique. It doesn't sound like any other musical instrument tradition in the world. People compare it to the organ because of the sustain, but that the attack, the drone, very interesting, very beautiful. But you see, after Patrick Byrne died, that was it. The tradition was dead because he had no students and it didn't carry on. But But of course, the cultural work that the harp didn't die. People knew there were harps. People knew the harp was important in Gaelic culture. It was important in national culture. It was the symbol of poetry. Everybody wanted harps up and running. Okay, and so from about 1800 onwards, there was continuing attempts to bring the harp tradition back to life. And the one thing that people didn't do was go to the old guys and say, just show us how it's done, because it was seen as a folk tradition, and these colonial issues come in. You can't go to the native harpers because they're part of the despised, suppressed culture. You have to come at it as an outsider, and you have to elevate it. So the entire revival is a massive colonial project, as far as I can see. It still is. I mean, even me doing historical work, I'm not from inside the culture, and so there's really interesting stuff going on. This is the first attempt. This is Margaret MacLean Clefane. She was a Gaelic speaker from lived on the Isle of Mull. She was connected to Sir Walter Scott. She provided him with a lot of the Highland traditions for his novels. And she and her sister played the harp, but they would never dream of looking to the Irish harpist for inspiration, so they went to London and got a lovely big pedal harp, because it's the harp and there's no difference between harp traditions in a lot of people's minds. And so she used this kind of harp to play the Gaelic airs to try and reconstruct the ancient harp music, and did very well. She was neglected for a long time because, being aristocratic lady, they never published anything. And there's work recently, there's currently work going on their music and traditions and collecting connections. In Ireland, the big pedal harps were made and used a lot. John Egan was a pedal harp maker, and he realised that actually he was missing a trick, because people kind of knew that the pedal harp wasn't really the ancient harp. And so you could get a bit closer without actually having to demean yourself and stoop to doing the real thing. You could get a bit closer by making a kind of pedal harp that's shrunken and little. And so John Egan invented the little portable harp with gut strings and with semitone mechanism, so it could change key and be very classical and continental in style. But it looks very Irish, it has shamrocks on it, and it's little and it's cute. So you can kind of pretend. And of course, this was very successful, and this is the origin of the gut strung harp that we're familiar with in Scotland and Ireland today. And that tradition carries on. In the 1890s in Scotland, for the start of the MOD, the Gaelic Singing Festival, they wanted harps to accompany the singing, and so they sent to London to a pedal harp maker. And he thought, well, if I do something like a pedal harp but make it look small and cute like the medieval ones, then that'll do. And so here we have these things with gut strings and set up to be played like a pedal harp. She's playing with her left hand the treble and her right hand the bass. No, she's playing the other way around, with her right hand the treble and her left hand the bass, which is the way you play a pedal harp. But you'll see that when I was playing in the old style, it's the other way around. Okay? So the left hand the treble and the right hand the bass is the old native style. And so this is an interesting way of seeing where's a person coming from. Which way round do they hold the harp? And that gives you an instant insight into where their cultural background is that they're coming at. This is Patuffa Kennedy-Fraser. Her mother, Margaret, was a collecting of Gaelic airs, arranged them for the piano in very high art music style. She's neglected a lot now because people say, well, she ruined the traditional music. Of course she didn't ruin it. She used it for her art music. But they played it on the piano, and then they thought, well, we should have it on the harp. And so Patuffa sent it to a London harp maker and got a little Irish harp, ordered specifically without shamrocks. And we should let you hear that. I've brought along a record of Patuffa. She published books and made recordings. So this is her record from 1926, I think. And I'll play it for you so you can hear. You can hear their take on how this music works. I wasn't organised enough. So their style is quite pianistic, which you would imagine, because Marjorie was a pianist, a piano arranger. But it's interesting that this is that they're really trying to they really tried to get a sense of the old Gaelic music and put it back in its context. They say in the introduction to their book about how to put it back on the harp is kind of reclaiming its birthright. So that gives you a sense of the mainstream of Scottish harp and Gaelic song performance practice in the 1920s. Heloise Russell-Fergus is this very interesting harpist. She was married at the same time, but I think she was younger. She kept going right through into the 1960s. She released a set of records that were kind of psychedelic, new age harp improvisations. So she's a very interesting bridge between that romantic Marjorie Kennedy Fraser world of the 20s and the kind of folk revival that kicked off in the 70s. She's been very neglected as well. Her niece has recently been doing a big biographical project, and you can hear some of her music on her niece's Facebook, I think. So she's interesting and worth paying more attention to. Henry Briggs in the 1930s redesigned the harp, and he was a violin maker. He was a very good instrument maker, and so he put a lot of technical innovations into it. And so a lot of the things that he designed into the harps in Scotland, his harps went to Ireland as well and were very influential there. So he kind of always set the standard, which we still have today. So there are people who are still playing his harps. Alison Kinnaird has one of his harps and still plays it. And so that's just very interesting as a kind of driving the tradition forwards. And that type of harp with gut strings designed and set up like a kind of miniature lightweight pedal harp and played in a technique derived from the classical pedal harp, that's become the mainstream type of harp in Scotland and Ireland. And you can see this is a scene from the Edinburgh Harp Festival where they have no problem getting a couple of hundred people to play all on stage at the same time. This kind of harp is really the norm and the mainstream. And I find that quite interesting, okay, the way the tradition turned itself over a couple of hundred years ago. You can talk about it in different ways. You can talk about the old tradition dying and a new tradition springing up to replace it, or you can talk about kind of colonial takeover, or you can talk about utter transformation. There's different ways of understanding what's going on here. Okay, we have 5 minutes left, and I was going to rattle through there's a parallel thing going on. Since 1800, people have known that these gut-strung instruments derived from the pedal harps are not the ancient native tradition. And so you have attempts to get the to get something different up and running. So right at the beginning of the mod, in 1892, they said, right, well, the way to get the harp up and running for Gaelic song is to commission copies of the museum instrument. So this is what you have. This is one of the live made by Glenn, an Edinburgh bagpipe maker. And the trouble is that if you look at Our Lady on the left, she's kind of trying to play it as if it's a pedal harp. And that works fine for the newly designed miniature gut-strung harps, but it doesn't work for a replica medieval harp. So I think what happened is they just went, oh, it doesn't work, we can't get it to work, and they switched to the new gut-string design. So it was kind of an attempt to get it working that fizzled out. But this is kind of interesting. This is what happens, is you see that the old tradition is different. You try and make it work, and you can't make it work, and so you kind of get frustrated. Mabel Dolmetsch, Arnold Dolmetsch, was a pioneer doing lute and harpsichord work, and towards the end of his life he kind of madly turned his attention to everything that he hadn't got around to yet, including the ancient Scottish and Irish and Welsh harp traditions. And he made some little harps. And I have one here from the 1930s. I was going to play it to you, but we've run out of time. So. So it kind of has a harpsichord-like sound because he was a harpsichord maker, so he kind of redesigned it to work according to his sense. And you can see she's playing it back to front, she's playing with her right hand high and left hand low in the continental classical tradition. And she doesn't have the unison strings in the middle to give the harp a drone. So, you know, you can try certain things, and you can leave other things out, and it changes the tradition. And this interests me as well, the way the tradition changes over time. And sometimes it changes under deliberate control, and sometimes it changes because you just don't realise how you could do it. Here's Alison Kinnaird again. She's great on it. She's the only person who gets two pictures in this slideshow, because she's also done a lot of work on the historical traditions, and so she has this very lovely copy of the Lamont harp, which I showed you a picture of earlier on. One of the historical instruments in the museum, with metal strings, and she does play it in the modern orientation because she started out on the gut-strung harp in that kind of classical pedal harp derived tradition. But she's done a lot of work on trying to understand the historical traditions and the old native idiom. And so it's worth checking out her work. She put out a CD where she put both traditions alternating, which is very interesting. It's on your bibliography, so that's a good way to try and understand how these different strands of tradition relate to each other. Okay. And I suppose she's done the most work to try and bring them back together again, except they don't fit together at all because they're completely different. One of them is ancient and native, and the other is sort of incoming colonial reinvention. But try, or you can at least contrast them. And this is Bill Taylor, and he's doing a lot of work right now reimagining the ancient traditions. He's kind of reinvented the old Gaelic harps as a miniature thing. And this is an interesting one, because other people are doing this miniaturization as well, but I think he did it first, and I don't quite understand where it comes from. So he plays these harps, and they're about half the size of the medieval harp. And of course, you have to invent a new repertory and a new way of playing for that. And so this is becoming, I wouldn't say popular, but it's got a presence on the scene, which is very interesting. And then the work that I'm doing, and the work that I'm doing with my colleagues in Ireland, is to have a kind of early music approach to the oldest strands of the tradition. So you get as accurate replicas as you can, and you try and set them up according to the historical evidence. You try and play them using historical techniques, and you try and follow everything as closely as you can, and when you come with new information and evidence, you change your practice to try and understand better what's going on. So this is my replica harp when it was brand new, and it's been changed a lot since then, because I always have to keep tweaking it, so keep up with new research. But that's it, we're out of time. Thank you very much.